Well, welcome and God bless you. My name is Paul Berry. I'm the senior pastor of Calvary Chapel, Santa Maria. I believe this is a unique opportunity for us on cable access TV to bring you segments of our regular services here. A service that is going to include not only the Word of God, line by line, precept by precept, but also that Word in the power of the Holy Ghost to change your life, even as I've seen it change so many people's lives in our congregation. I believe the Word of God has a unique power, a power that's far beyond the ability of speakers or churches that can affect your life, change your life. Romans 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So as you listen to the Word of God this morning, in the power of the Holy Spirit, let it change you, let it change your neighborhood, let it change the place in which you work, let it change your family, let it change the things that the Lord wants you to occupy until He is the bridegroom, comes for His blessed bride, the church. And I pray that that's soon. God bless you. So the last sentence of Ezekiel chapter 1 says, so when I saw it, I fell on my face and I heard a voice of one speaking. Verse 1 of Ezekiel 2. And he said to me, son of man, stand on your feet and I will speak to you. Wow, son of man, Ben Adam is the Hebrew. Like all of us, we are sons, daughters, children of Adam and Eve. We have a connection to He whom the Lord formed in intimacy with the design in the image and likeness of God so that we would bear within us a God record, a magnificent God record of intelligent design that scientists still cannot fathom, and yet they attempt to explain it through satanic and Luciferian ideas and theories like evolution. How dare they, when a mighty God has created each of us? Ezekiel receives this command from Adonai Yehovah. He receives it from a mighty God to, as it were, just a created man. How privileged Ezekiel is to hear from the living God and from his throne as he sees this being on the throne. And we'll see him at the close of chapter 2 with a scroll jutting forth from his throne. Jesus often spoke of himself as the Son of Man. In fact, it was his favorite term when he spoke of himself, the Son of Man. He used it in ways that described him as very common among all people. For instance, in Matthew chapter 8, verse 20, Jesus said to others, foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. I am just like every other man this night that must find some place to lay my head. But you see, some way, here He who created all things doesn't even have a foxhole or a nest to curl into tonight. But Jesus used the term also when He described Himself as the exalted one among all, above all men. John chapter 3, verse 13. No one has ascended to heaven but He who came down from heaven, that is, the Son of Man who is in heaven. Mark 13, verse 26. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. Friends, what that means is that when the sky opens in a Zechariah 14 manner over the city of Jerusalem, and Jesus begins to descend upon that grand city, we will not see Him as a being with six wings and four faces, but rather we will see Him in the likeness of man, as we saw in Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11, but also in the appearance of man as well. Who is God that can be described as man? Well, you know, our God cannot be. But Jesus said, if you've seen me, you have as much seen the Father. And we want to see Jesus. There's something immediately recognizable to us about a human being that satisfies our need for companionship, for comfort. Adam looked among all the animals before Eve was formed from his side. And he saw that there were none suitable for him. How wonderful that we will see a God descending in power and in glory with the saints of God behind him in Zechariah 14, descending upon the apex of the Mount of Olives and coming to set up his throne in Jerusalem. But we will see him as the Almighty God. We will see him in a John form, with eyes of fire and a sword coming out of his mouth. He will be awesome and powerful. He will be a glorious being worth bowing our heads and proclaiming with our mouths that Jesus Christ is Lord. Praise God for that. And in fact, John is told that the world will look upon him whom they pierced, and they will be ashamed. And Ezekiel says, and then, and this is so wonderful, so similar to John, as a matter of fact, as well, in Revelation. Then the Spirit entered me when he spoke to me and set me on my feet, and I heard him who spoke to me. And he said to me, Son of man, I am sending you. Notice that's repeated in verse 4. I am sending you to the children of Israel, to a rebellious nation that has rebelled against me. They and their fathers have transgressed against me to this very day. For they are impudent and stubborn children. I am sending you to them, and you shall say to them, Thus says Adonai Jehovah. They would immediately know, whoa, the priest is using the unknown name of the Almighty God. Wow. Well, it's a rebellious people. No, please, I doubt if you would be able to unless you have something like this in your hand, that the word rebel or rebellious is a different word in the Hebrew than it is used later on in verses 5 through 8. Interesting thing about the form in verses 3 and 4 is a form that describes really being cruel, cruel to God. Now, think of what that means. What would it take for you or for God to look at you and say, you know what? That was just cruel. The way you spoke about me, that just is just cruel. It's not representative of me. It's not who I am. That's not what I do. I don't think that way. I don't hate you one day and try to love you another. That's just cruel. Do we represent God at times in a cruel manner? I think we do, particularly when we're apart from the Word of God long enough and sincerely enough, where we start forming, as it were, our own God. We think in terms of, well, this is a better God than the real God. You know what? God would like me to get divorced. God would like me to commit adultery. God would like me to get drunk. God would like me to have that. God would like me to do that. Who's God? Well, I guess it's my God, because it sure isn't the God of the Word. Because when I do those things, or I represent my God, it's being cruel with respect to who he is. Had the nation of Israel been cruel with regard to the God of Israel, think of what the God of Israel had done for this nation. And they just shoved him to the side and paraded, as it were, these golden calves and these odd statues that they would burn their children on. Astonishing, abominable things, all the while representing this loving, comforting God, this wonderful, awesome God, as this cruel creature that in fact hated all of us and was seeking a way to just ruin your day. How dare we ever think that God has the purpose of ruining our day? Save for God, we wouldn't even have a day. I want you to know that. Except for God, you wouldn't even suck an air right now, okay? It's just as simple as that. Thank you, Jesus. Father, forgive me for representing you in a cruel way. Father, forgive me for thinking in terms of you outside of how beautifully the Scriptures describe you. Thank you, Jesus. We see in verse 5 and 6, he says in verse 5, as for them, verse 6 you'll notice, as for you. So let's talk about them first, he says in verse 5. Whether they hear or whether they refuse, for they are a rebellious house. Now, it's a different word here used. Yet they will know that a prophet has been among them. As for them, they may not listen. In fact, they will likely rebel against you, but in a different way, interestingly enough. The word that's being used here has at the root of it, the Greek root word is mara, but the root of it is mara. Different without perhaps the sound of the W at the end. Those of you who are familiar with at least some of Hebrew know that the word mara is bitterness. At the root of most rebellion, and used throughout the book of Ezekiel, over 90 times, this version, this form here, which has at the root of it bitterness. I'm rebellious because I'm just bitter with God. I'm not just representing him cruelly, but rather I've got a bone of contention to pick with God. I don't like his laws. I don't like who he is. He doesn't treat me fairly. He treats other people better. He doesn't give me what I have. You treated God bitterly? And when God has tried to speak to you through his word, through his spirit, have you turned a deaf ear? Notice, please. Verse 6. Excuse me, rebellious house. Well, impudent, where's that word? Impudent and stubborn, verse 4. Impudent and stubborn. God is speaking to you, and he's saying to you, I love you. Did you know the primary work of the Holy Spirit is not to turn your teeth gold, okay? It's to turn you to Jesus. Did you know that? Primary work of the Holy Spirit is to turn you to Jesus, friends. Primary work of the Holy Spirit is to convince you of the love of Christ and the power of his blood. Impudent. Have an idea what that means? Impudent means to be obstinate, severe, cruel, hard, grievous, sore, churlish, there's a word I don't use. Get the idea? And then stubborn, of course, you know real well. Determined not to change one's attitude or mind. Ever been stubborn with God? God ever said, here's what I would really like you to do. No. No way, God. That doesn't make sense at all. You mean in my poverty? To get more, I give. Now, what kind of accounting class did you take, Jesus? That doesn't make sense, but it makes perfect sense with our God. As for them, whether they hear or whether they refuse, they will continue to be a bitter house, a house of bitterness. As for you, son of man, now, how would it be, Ezekiel? I just want to say, in human terms, if all I ever spoke to was a house of bitterness, a house of contention, of impudence and stubbornness. Now, every church has its degree of that. That's just human beings being human. But I got to say, if I was Ezekiel and all I ever got was, you know, the sour, you know, like you were weaned on a dill pickle kind of thing, you know? I'd leave. I'd just quit. I mean, why? What's so special about these people that I got to put up with, you know, these attitudes? But God says, listen, as for you, Ezekiel, son of man, common guy, do not be afraid of them, nor be afraid of their words, though briars and thorns are with you. So ministering to them is going to be like ministering to a bunch of briars and thorns. Briars and thorns are with you, and you dwell among scorpions. Do not be afraid of their words or dismayed by their looks, though they are a bitter, rebellious house. Their bitterness is going to come at you like scorpions, like thorns, like briars. But Ezekiel, don't give up. I'm with you. It's me that's speaking through you. I'm sure Ezekiel's mind thought of all the many prophets in the past who had been very unceremoniously hacked to death. Isaiah, who came before him, was shoved into a log, and the log was sawed in two with Isaiah in the middle of it. Really, the devices of man to show how much hatred, you might say how much bitterness, there is for the message and the messenger of God. Ezekiel, know this. They're going to hate you. They're going to be stubborn. But don't be afraid of them. You shall speak my words to them, verse 7, whether they hear or whether they refuse, for they are rebellious. Thank you, Jesus. Isn't it true that the word of God will always succeed in that for which it's sent? Isn't it a glorious thing? You don't know what to say to this person who just outrightly hates you because you're a Christian. Just speak the word of God. You know what? It unties their shoes. It really does. They just can't handle it. I love you. Boop. But you, son of man, hear what I say to you. Don't let their bitterness make you bitter. That's what it's saying. Don't make the house of bitterness make your house bitter. So easy, don't you think? You know, if you hang around or all you do is spend time with people that are so bitter, what happens? You begin to be bitter as well, don't you? And God says, please don't let that happen. It's going to be possible, Ezekiel. It's going to be possible that the people I ask you to minister to, in their impudence and stubbornness, their bitterness, and their cruel talk about me, that it might begin influencing you, but please don't let it. Don't let it enter your house, dear friend. Listen, there is nothing about ministry that's easy. I think some people have this romantic idea about what it might be to be a pastor, you know? Come down to church here, sit around singing Kumbaya all day long. You know, kind of coast through the ether and sit down with Jesus for a while. It's so far from that, maybe you can't even imagine. But I love it to the center of my being. And God has given me a love for the impudent and the stubborn, and it's not easy. And fortunately, I have a very loving church and just a very respectful church. And you know, here's the thing. I appreciate the fact that there's not a lot of churches in town that have hour and a half services. You know, Raul Ries puts it this way, sermonettes for Christianettes. But I want to say to you, we have long worship because I need long worship. This heart needs long worship. We need a lot of scripture because this heart needs a lot of convincing. Thank you for your attendance and for your loving attention. I really appreciate that. Don't be rebellious like that rebellious house. Open your mouth and eat what I give you. How wonderful to think of the Word of God, the Word of God being spoken into the very intestines of Ezekiel. It's true that Ezekiel will be asked to eat the book, just as John was. And it will be sweet to the mouth, but bitter in the stomach. So often, that's how God's word is. At first, we eat it, and then as we contemplate it, we think, you know, there's things that got to change in my life. There's got to be change in this here person's life. Now when I looked, verse 9, there was a hand stretched out to me. And behold, a scroll of a book was in it. And he spread it before me, and there was writing on the inside. Now, keep in mind, this is the same scene as chapter 1. There are these creatures in each corner of this huge, glassy, you know, like a pane of glass. that has fire, and it looks, as Moses described it, a glass of sapphire. And on top of that glassy sapphire pane is this great throne with thunder and lightning coming forth from it, and the beings moving like lightning out of the presence, in the presence of His holiness, describing the glory that they see. John says that when they describe it, the saints of God fall on their face and toss their crowns. And I looked, and on the top of this throne, in the midst of this cloud, comes forth a hand. And in that hand is a scroll that is spread out. John describes the same scroll in Revelation chapter 5, verses 1 through 7. John says, "And I saw on the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll written inside and on the back, exactly the way Ezekiel describes it, sealed with seven seals," John says. "And then I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, 'Who is worthy to open the scroll and to loose its seals?'" By the way, this angel is calling out to the myriad of the saints, John says, around this glassy sea, being supported by these creepy, weird beings and these winding wheels, is a number of saints that cannot be numbered. And the angel cries out, "Who among you is open? Who is worthy to receive the scroll from the Father's hand?" And, well, are you kidding me? Who would dare approach the Father in heaven? Who would think in their wildest dreams, with absolute, immortal, incorruptible minds, incapable of sin, incapable of prideful thinking, no one among the saints think, "Yeah, I could do that. Yeah, you know what? I could do that." No. John says the entirety of the saints wept bitterly because they recognized none of them were worthy. There was no, impudent man standing up amongst them and thinking, "Yeah, I can take that guy." They all wept bitterly until Revelation chapter 5. "I wept so much," verse 4, "because no one was found worthy to open and read the scroll or to look at it. But one of the elders said to me, 'Do not weep. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the scroll and to loose its seven seals.' And John looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne and of the four living creatures, in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as though it had been slain." Imagine, why would Jesus appear in the midst of the saints of God as still this Lamb who was slain for our sins? Because that's who Jesus is, right here and right now. Loving, loving, loving. And He came and He took the scroll out of the right hand of Him who sat on the throne. Now, we don't discover what's on that scroll, either in Ezekiel or in the book of Revelation. There are many ideas about that scroll. But we do know in the book of Revelation, when the opening of those seven seals begins, the first six present tremendous catastrophes on this earth. The seventh seal then presents seven trumpet woes upon the earth, and the seventh trumpet presents seven bowls of God's wrath. All for the purpose of turning mankind for the last time to He who loves without end. Tonight, friends, the Spirit of God, I believe, has led you into all truth. And I'm grateful that I don't have to be that good of a teacher for the Spirit of God to be able to do what He has to do, because He succeeds in that for which it's sent, right? Praise God for that. But I want you to know, we're starting a journey with Ezekiel that's going to be unlike any journey you have ever been on before. And what we're going to see, what we're going to hear, what Ezekiel is going to be asked to do are things that in our lives we would think, "That guy's nuts. You know what? We better call 911 because that guy is weird." But he did what the Spirit of God asked him to do. And friends, there's times when you think, well, I don't know. Sounds pretty weird that the Spirit of God is going to ask me to speak to that person. But you know that there's power in obedience. There's power in giving up anything that might be considered in your heart, any degree of bitterness towards God right now. I ask you, are you bitter at God for anything in your life today? You bitter the way things turned out? Are you bitter about the way things will be tomorrow? Listen, there's a day coming, a new dawn arising, and the Son of Righteousness will rise, healing in His wings. And friends, you will weep no more. And heaven will be ours. As for me tonight, I'm going to plead the blood of Jesus upon my life, upon this church, that, Lord God, you would touch the bitterness of my life. Father, I thank you, thank you, thank you. First of all, for bringing the Holy Spirit to enter me. He's with me. He is in me. He's upon me, Father. And I recognize how glorious it is to have you, O Holy Spirit. I'm speaking to you, O Holy Spirit, right here in my life. Thank you for that. It's just amazing. It truly is. Father, I'm concerned that there be any root of bitterness in my life, any rebellion, Father, that might be something that I would harbor against you. Oh, Jesus, I plead the blood of Jesus. Forgive me. Maybe others tonight would be speaking to God as I am. Maybe others tonight would be pleading with our Heavenly Father. Forgive us, Father, of our bitterness or rebellion. Forgive us of speaking concerning you in a cruel way. Lord, I can't say I'm doing the best that I can, but I sure want to. And in the gap between the best and what I do, I pray, let not bitterness root itself within my heart, Lord God. Father, contentment deals with so many bitter ideas. I pray, Holy Spirit, give me power, give me love, give me the sound-mindedness of being content in your presence right now. Thank you, Father, for this church. Thank you, Father, that you deal with rebellion and bitterness and cruelty every day in this house, mighty God. And thank you for changing us, Lord God. You're changing us some every single day. Thank you, Father, for that. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you never leave or forsake us. Keep doing that work, I pray, O Holy Ghost. Keep doing that work, Jesus, I pray, until we see you face to face. Thank you for Ezekiel, Father, in Jesus' name. Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life and will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this word and in His Spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, Senior Pastor of Calvary Chapel.